Kayrana might be one of the biggest trolls of all time, and I love that about her as a mangaka, bro. I love it. Starting this off by saying, you'd expect there to be something special for the 100th chapter. It's top 5, I'm gonna subvert your expectations, moment of all time, because I'm gonna be honest, bro, she got my ass too. But there is good reasoning behind this. I believe it is because next week we are getting either the lead color page or just the color page in general. I also wonder if Kei Urano was pissed that she didn't get the cover for her 100th chapter, and instead the cover was given to a new manga that was coming out that I don't even think was announced until today. But all the more reason to come out swinging next week, right, with some sick ass color page. Thanks for being my favorite mangaka, Kei Urano. I appreciate you, just as every other fan of Gachiyakuta appreciates you. Moving along, I actually have a question lined up for you guys following this chapter. Y'all think these beasts are being controlled by someone? I'm talking specifically about the ones that are named and are in the designated no man's lands. I have a theory in regards to this, but that I think deserves its own video. Now, I know what you guys want to say. Kuro is dead, right? That's what you want to say. But is he? You guys so sure about that? Before they got the info, you sure? Or is Kuro also playing the game as well? This ties into my controlled beast theory as well, because notice that it did not touch him. Right? You guys notice that? I also proposed the question of Kuro even existing before, so hopefully y'all caught that as well. Now, Tori, the jungle no man's land, looks more like a refuge if I've ever seen one. The fact that there's even greenery down here says one of two things. Either these plants adapted to the environment, which I highly doubt, or someone is controlling these. Bro, there is so much going on in this chapter, so before we get into all of that, hi, I'm Damo Senpai. And we are here with chapter 100 of Gachiyakuta. Guys, we fucking did it, man. We hit chapter 100. Make sure y'all let it be known in the comments that we fucking told you so. Everyone who doubted this shit, we told you so. Shonen Oji, I fucking told you. And I'ma still tell you when the anime drop. Oh, don't worry, I keep receipts. Anyway, we hit 100 chapters, the anime's coming soon. Bro, I feel like a proud fucking father right now. I can't hold y'all. If you're new to the channel and have yet to subscribe, man, y'all know what to do. We're creating a fucking dynasty over here, bro. Creating one of the best communities on this platform. And by the way, if you are the person who emailed me about that Discord, let me know in the comments, because I ain't gonna lie, bro, that shit was hella confusing. I ain't know if it was spam or not. I ain't wanna reply. I ain't wanna do none of that. So I think it's best if you just like comment down below, and then we can discuss business. All right though, man, that's enough chatting for me and whatnot. Time to get into the video. Let me start this off by saying, no, Kuro is not dead. To be honest, I don't even think he existed in the first place. I think he is somewhat of a doll created to keep people away from the real info broker, whom I also think is the creator of the chokers, you know, the communication devices. Hence why he was leading Ruto to no man's land, right? Isn't it kind of weird? I kind of understand Zodil's line of thinking a bit more now. This was all likely what the game of tag was for, which, you know, I also pointed this out. We wanted to meet the creator, so the creator is probably here. And this beast we see is a means to protect him from intruders. It's crazy that my theory from like 10 chapters ago is coming to fruition right before our very eyes. I always thought it was too weird, right? Bro's body was oddly shaped, hands would randomly fit and unfit the gloves, even went as far to say that he wasn't a giver. Y'all remember that? This might also be the reason why Kuro didn't want Momoa to touch him as well. Because think about it. If you touch something that doesn't actually exist, that would ruin the whole meaning of what he's doing. Y'all better be prepared for a big reveal, because I think it's coming soon. That might be what chapter 101 in the color page is going to be for. I said I wasn't going to reveal my entire theory, but I pretty much did. Still plan on dropping the controlled beast theory at some point. Next, I got to get into the crash landing we had. Bro, This is easily one of my favorite visuals in Gachi Yakuza. Engine always came across as the dad of the series, and this definitely helped spread the idea because look at this shit. He's literally carrying all of them like children. I love that. I just had to bring that up. This was one of the weirdest reveals in this manga, and that is one of the No Man's Lands being a jungle. Yes, you heard me right. A fucking jungle. I'm not even sure how this shit exists in the first place, but let me cook for a second. How is it that such a lush area exists in what is supposed to be one of the most polluted areas on the ground? Follow mentioned this and was also of the same mindset, right? It's a bit too eerie if you ask me. Oh, and before we continue, there is something else that I want to add to my theory about these no man's land places and important people living in them. If the creator of these communication devices and also one of the Watchmen series holders lives in here, who lives in the no man's land that Ruto fell into? And the only reason I bring that up is because the conversation between Ruto and Engine made me think about it. I remember Samu asking Engine what he was doing around there in the first place, and he said he was just so happened to be taking a stroll out there. Was that all there was to it? Or was he visiting somebody? Just something to keep in mind as we progress through the story. I also think that due to all of the plants being here, this place isn't as toxic as we think it would be. Because, I mean, you guys know how plants work, right? All right, I'll leave that to your imagination if you don't. Anyway, another thing to note is that Momoa is nowhere to be seen along with Zodil. Even when we get further in the chapter and we see Zodil in a tree, Momoa is still not there. I wonder if she is just, off-screen hiding somewhere. I thought that was interesting because I don't think Zodil would want to put her in harm's way with how important she is. At least to me, bringing her in this jungle with such a threat lying in wait would be really bad on his part. Unless he was aware of all of this? Really, really important detail to keep note of now that I think about it, because she might spring out on Ruto just to read all of his memories, which could also hold something vital for Zodil. He seeks information from above, and who better to give that than the Spherite himself? But I kind of want to deviate from that situation and move on to this aftermath of what Ruto did. There was a string of varying, emotions of sadness here. Jabber was sad that he wasn't in pain. Fu was sad that, he probably got left behind. Hopefully this doesn't lead to him switching sides again. And Kathoni was sad that she let Zodil down by not stopping the cleaner. I only wanted to talk about this because we know when Fu feels like he gets left behind, that leads him to swapping teams. And I really don't want that to happen again, bro, because I think he was a really good addition to us, right? To the cleaners. I thought he was. So now let's get into the chunk of the chapter. And that is what transpired at the end. And obviously where I'm more than likely going to blow your minds. As we progress through the jungle, we stumble upon Kuro, who is posted up on this oddly designed pillar. Something to note here is that Kuro is not moving a single inch. We didn't see his eyes either, and with good reason too. Ruto understands that this is his chance to get the information, that this is his chance to finally obtain what he's been looking for this entire time. But Engine, being the goat that he is, understands that this is quite possibly a trap. Cue in Zodil, and of course he flings a rock past Ruto and Kuro into the water, all to lure out the beast. Notice how the beast did not touch Kuro, and how more than likely it's protecting him. Did y'all notice that? Hopefully you did. Engine understood that Zodil was using us as decoys, so that way he doesn't have to put himself in harm's way to get what he wants. That is when we get the full reveal of the monster. Well, we actually didn't, but we did. And does this design look familiar to any of you? You guys remember the mural from chapter 87? The ancestry chapter? I think this was intentional. I'm starting to think that these are like protectors of those descendants from these lineages that we've seen posted here. They also remind me of the weapons from Final Fantasy VII who are meant to protect the planet when it's under attack. It was such a fascinating reveal because if that is true, that is all the more reason that the creator of the Chokers lives here and why nobody is truly ever able to get him. What an ending to a chapter, man. It still has me thinking about many other things involving ancestry because there were three of these protectors on the mural. If this beast was indeed one of them, does that mean that the Watchman is also one of them? I made this case a long time ago, but I was called crazy. Are we ever going to meet the descendant of Makaka Iko, or have we been in his presence the entire time and didn't know it? Quite fascinating, don't you think? Anyway, That about wraps it up for this chapter. If there was anything that I missed that you thought I should have covered, make sure you let me know in the comment sections below. Also, if you have any theories in regards to what happened, feel free to fill me in the comments as well. Leave a like if you enjoy, subscribe if you're new. Really, really sick chapter, bro. Even though Kayurana trolled us at the beginning, I do think that this final panel was special. I think it showcased the story she was trying to tell us by dragging Ruto to all these specific places. Oh, and I forgot to mention, we had a double spread this chapter, which to me is always welcome. I love when Urana sensei gets to showcase her skills and she never, ever disappoints with those, bro. Let me get out of here and actually record these videos because I am just as interested to hear what you guys have to say about it. As always, man, I'm Damo Senpai, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.